Well, there's two points of view. There's Gene Roddenberry, dad, who was fairly standard father. He was there to support me, and he was also there to reprimand me when I made mistakes as a child. He passed away when I was 17, so I didn't really get to know him as an adult. So he was dad. But there is also Gene Roddenberry, the quote-unquote great bird of the galaxy, who I've learned a great deal from the fans, from books, from family. So, I mean, there's two totally different people. I mean, Gene Roddenberry, the great bird of the galaxy, was a human who had a son and was a father to a son. He was always very imaginative. I've spoken to family members who used to say, as a child, he used to sit in cardboard boxes and pretend he was Buck Rogers flying in space. So he was actually kind of the 1930s version of a nerd, I guess if you want to call it that way, where Star Trek fans are stereotyped. Well, he was a Star Trek fan before Star Trek began. He was a sci-fi fan before Star Trek even existed. My father was, he was obviously an airline pilot before I was born. He flew for a number of years after World War II. He was a pilot in World War II. And his plane went down in the Syrian desert as a pilot, as a commercial airline pilot. And I believe he was the only officer or the only person who lived with 11 other people. And he was somewhat of a hero. He led them to safety. And I think pretty much after that, he gave up flying and decided to join the police force. His father was a police officer. And I think he basically followed in his father's footsteps. His brother was a police officer. Dragnet at the time was buying stories from officers, and he submitted his stories to them. And I think he just really fell in love with writing. He was doing some, you know, freelance writing on the side and some police work on the side and writing for the chief of police on the side. So I think his passion just went with his imagination. He left police work and decided to become a writer. I believe he was an officer when he was submitting stories to studios. And I'm not sure if it was a Star Trek pitch or not, but at one point he went into a executive's office in his police uniform to submit a script. And I think the executive at the time was pretty much so scared that he accepted the script no matter what. So I'm not sure if it was ever shot, but I think being in uniform at the time probably helped him.
Check the circuit.
All operating, sir.
It's more of a guess, but I think the pilot, the one that didn't air, was his favorite. That was, I mean, if you know the story about that, he had made The Cage, gone way over budget, showed NBC, and they said, no, but we're going to give you more money to do a second pilot. I think that's been the first time and only time in history that's ever happened.
Spock here.
Landing party, come in.
There is no survivors encampment, number one. This is all some sort of trap.
I don't know if Spock was my dad's favorite character. He might have been. I mean, my dad was a very big believer in logic. I mean, he felt that everything is logical. I mean, I hate to sound like the character, but there's logic to everything. But as he described with the rest of the characters, logic isn't the only avenue. And as I said earlier, it's a combination of emotion and logic. And I think McCoy and Spock were the devil and the angel on Kirk's shoulders.
By which time he would have been eating fruits, vegetables,
probes
nuts.
Of phasis indicate very little.
And probes have been known to be wrong.
Doctor, are you speaking scientifically or emotionally?
Gentlemen.
I think the lead of all of his shows, the leads have always embodied him to some degree. And whether it was personalities that he wished he had, personalities he thought he had, or simply personalities that he did have, I think he put them all into one character. And I think he created the ideal Gene Roddenberry in each one of those characters. I think my father was very happy with his life. I mean, extremely happy with his life. I think he touched lives. Star Trek was a vision he had. Star Trek was an idea. And he worked his ass off to get it out there. He made sure it happened. I mean, he did everything he could. He worked hard. He got it out there. And you know what? Star Trek got out there. And it was a failure at first. You know, the first three seasons were considered a dismal failure. But it touched lives, it came back. I think he saw his life as a huge success. Even though he didn't plan it, one of his things he always used to say was, all part of my plan. He'd sit back and just say, just the way I planned it. Gene had his victory with the next generation. The next generation came about basically because someone told him he couldn't do it again. The first time, it was a fluke. And I think any time you said something like that to my father, that was the wrong thing to say, because he would do everything he could to prove you wrong. I think my father's choice to not incorporate religion or God directly into his work was basically first a political business decision. And I've heard this in the industry before, if we talk about religion, any specific one, we lose everyone else in our audience. So I think that was a part of it. But I think my father was a humanist. He believed, I'll tell you what, he didn't believe in blind faith. He did not believe in blind faith. He did not believe that, well, we'll just wait and God will solve our problems. Or, I stubbed my toe, that must have been God's wish. He believed humans make their own decisions.
Don't you understand? It's not the sun up in the sky. It's the Son of God.
Caesar and Christ, they had them both. And the word is spreading only now.
Philosophy of total love and total brotherhood. It will replace their imperial Rome, but it will happen in their 20th century.
Wouldn't it be something to watch, to be a part of? To see it happen all over again.
A vivid memory of my father, something that I remember to this day and cherish, is when we used to go bumming. I was probably about 8 years old. It would be on a weekend. He would take me in his Cadillac DeVille, or Seville, I don't know which one, and we would go to the Santa Monica Pier. But on the way there, he would get on the freeway, he would shift the car into second gear, the RPMs would shoot through the roof, and he'd say, we're going speedster. He was actually going probably 55 or 65, but I couldn't see over the dashboard, so I'd be grabbing on, thinking that we're going super fast. And we'd get down there, and we'd have a great father-son day. You know, he'd give me money for the arcades, or he'd knock over the jugs and win me a doll, or whatever the case is. At the end of the day, we would go have dinner and talk about, you know, the disgusting things like girls, icky. Then we would get home, we would pull into the garage, he would turn off the car, and he would look over, and he said, I'm Gene Poo-Poo Roddenberry. And I'd look over at him, and I'd say, I'm Rod Poo-Poo Roddenberry. And that was kind of the ceremonious way we ended the night. It was just a guy's day of bumming. And that's Dad. If anyone ever asks, what memory do you have of your dad, that will be the memory I have of my dad. I am extremely proud to be named Eugene Roddenberry.